Whether you have an older car with a basic ignition key or a slightly newer car with a chipped or a transponder key, or even a vehicle with keyless entry and start, they can all unfortunately be stolen with varying degrees of difficulty. So today I'm going to tell you how this can happen and what you can do to try to stop it. Now before we start, do me a huge favor and subscribe to my channel, but also click on the bell notification so that you are notified when my new videos come out. All right, so we'll start off with an older vehicle that has a basic key. And again, I'd like to reiterate that the information I'm about to share in this video is supposed to help people stop thieves from stealing their cars, not to help thieves steal cars easier. So again, please make sure you use this information for good, not evil. All right, so as I'm sure we've all seen it in the movies, the thief that's trying to steal a car will get into the car, then break these plastic covers that are covering the steering column, then grab what looks to be two random wires underneath here, touch them together, start the vehicle, and get on down the road. Now, some of you may have seen in my previous videos, you may be able to start a vehicle that way, but you're not gonna be able to drive it because the steering lock is still gonna be there. You're not gonna be able to turn the wheel, you're not gonna be able to get far. Now, what is more likely to happen in real life is that the thief will actually try to break your ignition lock cylinder. As you can see, there was an attempt to do just that here. And no, the thief we're talking about is not me. I bought this car this way. And the way they usually do this is that they get a strong screwdriver or maybe a chisel and a strong hammer. They put the screwdriver in the ignition, they whack it, and get it to a point to where they can either turn the screwdriver and turn the ignition to both break the steering lock and start the vehicle, or to the point where they can actually remove the ignition lock cylinder, and then with that same screwdriver, they can get in there and get to the ignition switch, which is the electrical component that makes up your ignition lock and cylinder assembly, turn that, start the vehicle, and since the ignition lock cylinder is not in there, your steering lock is disengaged and they can drive that car. Also, another way they do this is to use a slide hammer like this. They get a screw in your ignition, put the slide hammer on the screw, pop out of your ignition, then use a screwdriver to turn the ignition switch, start the vehicle on the way. Now, on some cars, it may just be easier to get to the ignition wires by breaking this plastic cover. So they break this plastic cover, get to the ignition wires, start the car, then get a good strong grip on the steering wheel, yank it real hard, break the steering lock, and then drive your car. All right, now as far as what you can do to try to stop this or at least make it harder for the thief to take your car, which at the same time is cost effective and doesn't require you to go out and buy an expensive alarm system. Well, in so many words, it's called a kill switch. So yeah, basically what you need to do is to find out which wire supplies battery power to your ignition switch. Once you find that wire, you cut that wire and install a manual switch, AKA a kill switch, which unless it's turned on or switched on, power cannot go from your battery to your ignition switch. So no matter what the thief does up here, even if they break your ignition lock cylinder and turn the ignition switch, they cannot turn on the vehicle because that kill switch has been disabled. You want to make sure you don't install that kill switch around the steering column or somewhere that's visible. You want to try to hide it, obviously. You might want to install it under the dash on the passenger side, between the driver's seat and the center console. Again, anywhere but around the steering column. Also, you want to cut that wire, not up here, because just in case they take these covers off, they don't see it. You want to cut that wire further down, or even better yet, closer to the junction box inside your engine bay. All right, next up, we'll cover vehicles that come with a transponder key, or what they call a chipped key. Now, I'm putting both of these cars in the same category because stealing them, more or less, in my opinion, is gonna work the same way. But the difference is, let's say this is a transponder key. Once you put this key inside the ignition, that key will send the radio frequency to the transceiver. And if that radio frequency matches what's programmed into the computer, then your car's computer will allow your car to be started and driven. Now, on the other hand, let's say you have a key that has a specific amount of resistance, or a chip here that has a specific amount of resistance. Now, as one can guess, once you put this key in the ignition, your car's computer will test and sense the amount of resistance coming through this key, and if that resistance doesn't exactly match what's programmed into the computer, it will not allow your car to start or be driven. Now, these cars are actually fairly difficult to steal. They cannot simply steal it on a whim. You know, they cannot be walking on the street, see your car in the driveway, decide to steal that car and, you know, be in it and be driving it under 2 minutes. What they'll need to do is to first find out your VIN number, then try to impersonate a used car dealer, which you may be surprised is not that difficult to do. Then they need to go to the dealership for your car's make and go to the parts department and tell them, hey, I have a car that They didn't come with a key. I need to have a key made. I'll do the programming myself. All I need you to do is to make the right key for this VIN number. Now, if they have the correct, you know, fake business number, or they act the right way, a lot of times these parts departments, they don't ask for ID or registration information if they think that the guy is a used car dealer. They'll just have a key made for that VIN number without programming it, sell it to the guy. All right, so with the right key, the thief can easily get in the car and put the key in the ignition and disable the steering lock. But since the key they have doesn't have the correct resistance or doesn't emit the right frequency, they're not going to be able to start the vehicle. To get around that, what they need to do is to program the new key to your car's computer using an advanced scanner. Now, all of this not only requires a lot of pre-planning and spending money on scanners and whatnot, but it's simply too much risk to be sitting inside a car you're trying to steal for 10, 15 minutes trying to program a key. So yeah, most of the times thieves will try to avoid these cars and move on to easier targets. And these security systems are actually the reason why auto theft has been going down for the last 10, 15 years in the States. So next up, we'll move on to vehicles that have keyless entry and keyless start. Now, this is obviously for a Hyundai, but I don't have that vehicle here. So for demonstration purposes, we'll just simply assume this key is for this 2009 Pontiac G3. So the way keyless entry and keyless start setups work is that the key is always emitting a radio frequency. And if that frequency matches, the car's computer will unlock the door and allow you to push start the vehicle. Now, this is unlike the transponder key. The transponder key we talked about only emits a radio frequency when it's inserted into the ignition. So yeah, the weakness of this setup is that this key is always emitting the radio frequency. Now, the way thieves use this to steal these cars is by using what's called a relay box. So basically, this is a two-man job. Toll number one stands with one box next to your car. Toll number two goes with another box close to your house, maybe to the front door where you might be hanging your car keys, or goes around your house trying to pick up the radio frequency that's being emitted by your key. And once it picks up that radio frequency, it relays that frequency, hence the name relay box, to a back toll number one. Then once that radio frequency here, it's that relay box emits that radio frequency, your car thinks that the key is near it, opens the door, and allows for one of the assholes to start your car and drive it. Now, I assume some of these relay boxes will also record the frequency and keep on emitting the frequency even when they get out of range, so that the car doesn't stall out. Also, I assume some of the cars actually only require the frequency to start and they don't die when the key, I guess, it's out of range. But yeah, this is doable and people are doing it. A lot of high-end vehicles, a lot of Mercedes, Audis are being stolen this way. So you might wanna, if you have one of these cars, you might wanna watch out for this. So yeah, don't hang your key near your door. Try to put the key in the center of the house, or better yet, use an RFID blocker, which stands for radio frequency identification blocker, or wrap your key in aluminum foil, or put the key inside of a metal box. Anything made out of metal will most likely block most of the frequency that's being emitted by the key. And of course, you can always install a kill switch. You can install a kill switch on any vehicle, or anything electrical for that matter. So don't forget to subscribe and hit that bell notification that next to the subscribe button. But also make sure you watch this video in this corner. I'm sure you'll like it. All right, thanks for watching. I'll see you guys next time.